So October 2020, onboarding at NIH after a cross-country move and in the height of the pandemic, and the settling of new home was all daunting, to say the least. And of course, I don't have a wife on hand. I guess that's... I might get into trouble for that. But the observations at that time of Surgeon General Jerome Adams, as he looked into the mouths of patients he treated as an anesthesiologist, alarmed him. And it prompted him to actually ask about the oral health status of this nation. But it was at a time when all of that got initiated in 2019. The pandemic hit, we had the border crisis, we had mental health and gun violence rising to being really a pandemic on its own, prompted our new Jerome Adams to actually turn this over to NIDCR, and we felt the responsibility to spearhead this report to completion. Really owe Bruce Dye and Judith Albino, who will be acknowledged in a few minutes, for that effort. But it was really Larry who held my hand and steered the way so that we would have the support of the new Surgeon General, Vivek Murthy, as we published 7 articles that were position papers in good journals, and aggressively almost disseminated the information that we thought belonged to you. And I hope that each one of you will go back to your schools and revisit that 25-page executive summary and make it part of your students' thinking as they prepare to live lives of, as compassionate clinicians who care about the well-being of all. I hope you do that. Some are and some are not, but think about it. What was expected of me, and I expected that, the report I didn't, so it just plopped into my lap and I had to think on the spot and get it through, was the strategic plan that Malta actually initiated. But it was very important to revisit the plan in the context of what the pandemic taught us. It didn't make any sense to go back and rehash things that were part of the past when the world had actually changed. And we drove the plan in a different way, to be disease agnostic, to look perhaps beyond the immediate and look at the overarching compelling reasons for us to want to translate for the benefit of the patient. In those days, most of us who wrote R1s or had the basic sciences on one end, the clinical researchers on the other, and something in between that was fuzzy, preclinical animal research. Now it's more of a continuum where every domain of research actually feeds into the benefit of health for the patient who is in the center. So that doesn't put anyone at odds with each other. And the closer you are in the spectrum, the more likely you are to actually make a difference that drives a cure or a therapy. So that, I think, was the driving change. And of course, we have our goals set up with the very important charge that we evaluate what we're doing at all times and change as we go along. So we stay nimble and flexible, and that's what the pandemic taught us. We also felt the need to define or redefine the best science as being a very inclusive activity. And that means that the continuum with multi-directional connections between the basic and clinical as well as population sciences will always keep the patient in the center. So that definition doesn't exclude anyone from joining our workforce and being valued as contributing to that continuum. If we don't have the eyes of the clinician chairside, as you emphasize, we're not likely to take what we struggle with in the clinic and make it a finding or a discovery. And it's multi-directional. Now, the national search for a deputy director was essential to start and proved successful. And I'm so thrilled that we were able to attract Jennifer Webster Syriac from the University of North Carolina. Who's truly a fantastic partner to have. So my kid in a candy shop experience started to bubble through as I just became intoxicated with the intellectual rigor of that campus, of the NIH's campus. The alliances that were formed in these 2 years are genuine, and the working relationships actually formed as a result, really laid the foundation for new collaborations that we will continue to forge for the future. I stood back in awe as Lillian Shum's team launched 4 transformative initiatives that magically form a sentence. So we are now primed, who knows what that stands for, the dental public health, yeah, to move ahead. That is the Cancer Initiative with NCI, with impact, TMD. And of course, there's Rejoin One, which is a collaborative with another institute on joint pain. So change is the only constant at NIH, and I quickly became, again, captivated with the emergent themes that focus on integrative sciences, whole person health, community-engaged research now exploding into community-led research, where the community actually has a stake in it and runs, conducts the research that we can only benefit from. The need to balance our portfolio from curiosity-driven to use-driven research, which is relevant to patients, and directed to improve the lives of patients and communities. Now, multi-omics, as you know, is propelling fields of science and technology, and the promise of open data, as long as it's sensibly gathered and sensibly inputted, will really influence how primed ahead and impact will start from ground zero. We're going to make sure that we have that harmonizable, common data element driven, solid data that is meaningful, robust, and actually sustainable. So haunting to me all through this discovery process, where I was truly with the eyes of a two-year-old, my little granddaughter, was the fact that the report pointed to something alarming. It was a great time to celebrate our discovery research, all the great findings, but we hadn't moved the needle in areas of public health concern. 4 out of 5 children in this country suffer from untreated decay. If you're old enough, you're likely to be at risk for periodontal disease. HPV positive oropharyngeal cancers are rising to exceed cervical cancers, and I can go on and on. And that haunted me because I wondered then how best we can move the needle by taking advantage of this integrative era we live in to bring forth actually all the sciences that can bear on the improvement of the life of a patient. So I took on the responsibility with only one true goal, which was to advance NIDCR as my authentic self, creating the sense of value and belonging that we felt we had to do for our community. Being the people person I am, I revel in that kind of activity, as you all know. And I focus now, and we are all together, focusing on the connectome. It's one of the omics, but it's called the connectome, which is to forge these relationships with fellow institute directors, with our stakeholder groups, ADA and ADEA, like never before, in meaningful collaborations with very designated common goals. We share missions with them. Industry partners, patient advocates, focusing on the best science and the training of diverse generations that match the demographics of our nation. And I think if I had to envision the future, I would predict that data-driven solutions, which is going to be a new office at NIDCR, it just happens to have the acronym DDS, we'll have these elements. Now, why are we doing that? It's expensive, and we're going to try to leverage as best as we can. It's because we actually need real-time data. We need to understand our disease trends, susceptible high-risk populations by zip code, and throughout lifespan, right? There's a need. I predict and hope that salivary diagnosis in 25 years from now, and I hope I'm still alive to see this, will be the mainstay of medicine and oral health, that we have a 50% reduction in caries, that we actually can develop an anti-caries vaccine. Whilst we do other things, you know, the silver diamine fluoride project and providone iodine and probiotics are all in the works. That periodontal disease, we understand its molecular pathogenesis before we try regeneration, really understand it and how it contributes to systemic conditions. And we have now, we're getting down to that meat on the bones aspect of all of this, that with squamous cell carcinomas, we have preventive means, early predictive biomarkers. Prevention is really needed in that area more than anything else because the risk factors for head and neck cancers and HPV are the same risk factors that cause cardiovascular disease, metabolic syndrome, diabetes, the same stuff. Smoking, e-cigarettes, alcohol, bad nutrition, all of them are in common, and we need to find that way to do it. The new generation of smart dental materials are key, and I just predict that we will have a replacement for amalgams very quickly. Okay, so I want to end here by reminding you that about this time, 75 years ago, 74 years ago, Harry Truman was scratching his head, wondering why young men could not be enlisted to war because each one of them actually had ravaged mouths full of decay and pain. And he felt the need to create a national institute that would look at the biology of this condition as well as others. And we stay true to that mission today. So I want to end saying that. I want to end with actually the most important thing I need to do today, which is to acknowledge people in the audience who can't be on stage. It was impossible to fit us in, as it's impossible to fit all our the audience. I want to first acknowledge Jennifer, who you've met, Matt Hoffman, who is who leads a very credible intramural research program that distinguishes NIDCR on our campus and in the world. Matt, thank you for your leadership. I really, truly appreciate it. Yes, and we have DIR speakers featured because we wouldn't dare do DER because we'd offend one or two of you in the audience, so we are keeping it for another time. Lillian, your leadership, your ability to step up and take all my crazy ideas and make them happen is very, very appreciated. Thank you. You have a marvelous team. I don't know, Lynn King, are you here, Lynn? There you are. A stalwart, beloved figure in training and career development. Thank you also for stepping up. And your team with Anissa Brown and others are incredibly valuable to NIDCR's mission to train the generation of compassionate and well-informed researchers. Janice, thank you for your leadership at the Office of Clinical Director. And I think I can say that Martha kind of referred to you anonymously, but she was talking about you. Marion, for your deputy directorship. And I want everyone who works at NIDCR right now to stand up so that we can acknowledge you. You are the village.